In Jeremiah 32, I got you standing, and I'm going to read a lot of scripture, so you're going to be standing for a while, but not as long as me. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 6. And Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Behold, Hanamel, the son of Shalom, thine uncle, shall come unto thee, saying, Buy thee my field that is in Antioch, for the right of redemption is thine to buy it." So Hanamel, my uncle's son, it's his cousin, but Hanamel's his uncle's son, came to me in the court of the prison according to the word of the Lord and said unto me, "Buy my field, I pray thee, that is in Antioch, which is in the country of Benjamin, for the right of inheritance is thine, and the redemption is thine. Buy it for yourself." Everybody say, "Buy it for yourself." Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord, and I bought the field of Hanamel, my uncle's son, that was in Anathoth, and weighed him the money, even 17 shekels of silver. And I subscribed the evidence, sealed it, took witnesses, weighed him the money in the balances. So I took the evidence of the purchase, both that which was sealed according to the law and custom, and that which was open. And I gave the evidence of the purchase to Barak, the son of Neriah, and the son of Messiah, in the sight of Hanamel, my uncle's son, and in the presence of the witnesses, and subscribed the book of the purchase before all the Jews that sat in the court of the prison. And I charged Barak before them, saying, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these evidences, this evidence of the purchase, both which is sealed and the evidence which is open." Everybody say the evidence which is open. "And put them in an earthen vessel, that they may continue many days. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall be purchased again in this land." Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 23. It says, "Buy the truth and sell it not." Buy the truth, obtain the truth, and don't sell it. Also, wisdom and instruction and understanding. And everybody say amen to the reading of the word of God. Turn to somebody and tell them this morning, buy the truth and sell it not. Amen. You may be seated. God bless you. Buy the truth and sell it not. When we're looking at this, and we'll get into this story a little more, but Jeremiah is buying a field that is basically worthless. He's in prison under the king of Zedekiah, the king of Judah, who really is just a puppet position there that's been put there by the king of Babylon, because Babylon's already come in and conquered them and already got the victory over them. And so he's just put Zedekiah in that position, and the king Zedekiah decided he's going to rebel. So here comes Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. He's coming to just wipe everything off now. And Jeremiah, the prophet, he knows all this. And so during this process, God comes to him and I says, "I want you to buy a field, amen, from your cousin that is in the city that is called Anathoth." And he said, "I want you to buy that field." Now, Anathoth was probably already under Babylonian seizure, because they were getting ready to take Jerusalem at the time of this story is going on. But Jeremiah, he believes in the word of the Lord. And so he does what the Lord had asked him to do. He bought this field. But when we think about purchases and the greatest purchase that you've ever made or the greatest thing that you've ever obtained. The greatest thing that we'll ever attain is truth. The whole world is looking for truth. And thank God it's in the Word of God. Amen? So as we look into this situation, we have to really determine, I guess, what is truth? And so let's go to the Word of the Lord to determine exactly what truth is. Well, number one, God is truth. Amen. God is love. That's truth. Do you know God loves you? Do you know God cares for you? Do you know that God died for you? That he shed his blood for you, like they sang about? Do you know that this morning? But love isn't really love unless it comes with a choice. He could force us to live for him, but he loves us so much that he just prepared the way before us. And it's up to us to buy in to this truth. Can you say amen? Jesus was praying in the flesh to the Father. He was praying for his disciples, and he told them to sanctify them through thy truth. And he said, thy word is truth. In John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 4, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. It's the revelation of who God is. The Word of God is the revelation of who God is. Truth. Verse 9 in John chapter 1 says, that was the true light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Every man. Do you believe that today? I believe it. It's in the Word of God. Somewhere along the line and along the life of every individual is going to come that inkling of what's it all about. What is truth? And he says, he lighteth every man that cometh into the world. That's why you're here this morning. This may be your first time or your 101st time. It doesn't matter. It's because you have come unto the truth. You have come unto the light. Amen. The light has illuminated something in your life. The true light, he says in verse 9, which lighteth every man. So as we read this, Jesus is the true life, the true light. Amen. So there must be a false light. Amen. There is a false light. There's a lot of different lights that are in the world, a lot of different things that are saying, here's truth, and this is truth, and this is the way. Amen. But Jesus is the only way. As many as received him, you've got to receive this, amen? To them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe. And I just want to say that are sold out, that have bought the truth. Even them that believe on his name, which were born. We have to be born into this kingdom, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word, in verse 14, was made flesh. This truth was made flesh in the form of Jesus Christ and dwelt among us. This is how bad God desires to have a relationship with you. We need to make it personal this morning and to realize God desires to be with me. We need to realize this morning that God thinks you are somebody, amen, that you are important. The world may have thrown you away. Your family may have thrown you away. You may feel like you can't hardly get your head up above the ground. But I want you to know that Jesus Christ, hallelujah, died for you. He loves you. This flesh, this Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. we're defining truth here today, and we understand that it's the Word of God, and the Word of God became flesh in the form of Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the Word, and the Word was God in the beginning. So Jesus is God. Hallelujah. This is truth. Amen. When Jesus was talking to his disciples and he was trying to tell them what it was going to take for them to be disciples of his, it got pretty down to the road. It got pretty nitty gritty. And the Bible said a lot of them turned back after this. And then he turned to his 12 apostles and said, "Are you going to leave me also?" And Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Amen. In John chapter 14, Jesus was talking to his disciples again, and he says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you." Hallelujah. Folks, this world is not our home. We're just a passing through. We're ambassadors for Christ. We are the sons and the daughters of Almighty God. Hallelujah. Just here for a moment, Jesus is coming back for his church. Amen. Don't let your heart be troubled on all the things. He said, "I go to prepare a place for you." Look at your neighbor and say, "Jesus is preparing a place for you." "And whether I go, you know, in the way, you know." And Thomas, one of the 12, speaks up, says, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. We don't know what you're talking about. And how can we know the way?" And Jesus said unto him, "I am the way and the what? The truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Amen. That is truth. Folks, this thing was not done in a corner. Amen. This thing wasn't done over here on the sideline. Amen. But Jesus was crucified in front of a multitude of people in Israel. Amen. Jesus was crucified and he rose again. Amen. And his disciples saw him. Up to 500 of his disciples saw him for nearly 40 days. Amen. And he talked to them, speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. Amen. This thing was not just made up somewhere in the corner, in the sidelines. Amen. And this truth is so powerful that every one of those disciples was willing to sacrifice their own lives to be martyrs for this truth because they bought in to the truth. Amen. And so when Peter was there on the day of Pentecost, Jesus was risen. He says, "I'm going back now." Amen. And he said, "I want you to go to Jerusalem and wait for this promise that the Father was sending him." And when they were there, Peter, the Holy Ghost was poured out upon them, and they all began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And those that are around them saying, "What does this mean?" And Peter stood up. "This was what was prophesied, that in the last days I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh." And it's happening all over the world. I said it's happening all over the world. It's happening in every denominational church. The Holy Ghost is moving because it's a promise. It's a promise. The question is, do you have it today? Have you received the baptism of the Holy Ghost? It's yours to receive. Peter began to preach to them, and they began to tell him, he says, "You know, this Jesus that was here, he was the Messiah. He was the Christ, and you crucified him." And when they heard the preaching of Peter, they got convicted, and they asked men and brethren, "What shall we do?" And Peter said unto them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." Any Bible scholar will tell you this is the beginning of the church in Jerusalem. Amen. Because this is what the apostles did, the Acts of the Apostles, or the Acts of the Holy Spirit, if you will, is what they did after Jesus was already gone. What did they do with this truth? And Peter preached to them that day, and he told them, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off. That's us. We're afar off. Even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Now, we are living in a day when it's an easy believism, if you will, in the religious world, that you can just sit on your couch and accept the Lord Jesus Christ into your life and you're saved. But believing goes a lot further than that. If you believe in something, you're going to act upon it. And the more you believe in it, the stronger you're going to act on it. Amen. Now, we can't do the work for salvation. Jesus had to do that. He's already done that. He's paid the price. And we are saved through the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen? But that doesn't give us just an easy ticket into heaven. We have to believe in this with all of our heart. We've got to be committed to this with all of your heart. Amen? This is not just some kind of a social club or something that we like to do on the weekends. No, we are here today because we have bought into the truth, hallelujah, that Jesus Christ is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, hallelujah. And he's gone away to prepare a place for us, and we are waiting for his soon return, hallelujah. And while we wait, we are busy about the Lord's business, amen, hallelujah, hallelujah. So how do we save ourselves? Well, Peter told us to repent and be baptized and you'll receive this gift. It's a gift. But let's look at Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which a man, when he hath found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath and buyeth that field. Kind of like Jeremiah was buying a field. This man finds something in his life that is worth selling all that he has. Amen? Now, I'm not talking about your finances, although if their finances are holding you back, then maybe you need to get rid of some of them. Amen? But it's talking about selling out our life. Amen? They say that, you know, this gospel is free, but it's going to cost you everything. How determined are you, hallelujah, to buy this truth? This man found something. He was just walking through the field or whatever, and he noticed something on the, began to dig it up a little bit and noticed it was a great treasure. Amen. Maybe $1 million. Hallelujah. So he went and he sold everything that he had to buy this field. And we would say, well, that's a no-brainer. If I'm walking across the field and I find $1 million and hidden there, and then the property's for sale, I'm going to go sell my measly little $5,000 truck and try to buy this field. That's a no-brainer because it's worth so much. Amen. But really, when we think about the truth of God, it's a no-brainer, folks, that there is nothing else in this world that's going to give you hope. This world is passing away. This world is going by the wayside, but Jesus and his church is going up. Hallelujah. Jesus is worth buying into. Buy the truth and sell it not. There was a man of the Pharisees in John chapter 3, a man by the name of Nicodemus. He was a ruler of the Jews, and he came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, yeah, I am a miracle worker come from God. No, he didn't say that. He looked at him and said, I say unto thee, except a man be born. Remember, we already said you got to be born into this kingdom. A man has to be born. He cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus said unto them, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and to be born? Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man is born of the water, baptism, and of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And I was just reading this, and I was just thinking, you know, Nicodemus, he really didn't ask him what I needed to do to be saved. He didn't really ask him what I needed to do to enter into the kingdom of God. But Jesus just came out and told him what he needed to do. Nicodemus is like each and every one of us. He was a religious ruler. And the religious rulers of that day, they were plotting on how they were going to get rid of this man, Jesus. But Nicodemus realized that this is a no-brainer. We're seeing the works of this man. We're seeing what this man is doing. And I've got to talk to him. I've got to find a relationship with him. I've got to introduce myself to him and to find out what this is all about. Nicodemus really wasn't wanting to find out, but Jesus told him. He had that inkling within his heart and within his mind. Each of us comes by that way. We all want to know, and that's again why we're all here today, some on different levels of what we want to buy in the field, amen? But nonetheless, Jesus is just telling you, you got to be born again to enter into the kingdom of God. Amen. When we look in this John chapter 3 verse, Jesus ends his conversation with Nicodemus in verse 21. He said, but he that doeth truth, he that doeth truth. He's talking to Nicodemus, telling him what he needs to do to enter into the kingdom. And he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds might be made manifest. We have got to get ourselves on an altar, amen, of sacrifice to say, Lord, here I am. I bring myself to you. I want truth to come into my life. I want the light to shine into my life, amen, that your deeds are going to be manifest. The word of God, it's quick, it's powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, amen, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. And we don't like that sometimes. We got those little tucked away areas where we keep. But when you come to the truth, it shines the light. Hallelujah. And we got to buy the truth. Because it's what's going to be our salvation. It's what's going to bring us closer to Almighty God. Amen. Doeth means to spend. It means to deal without any delay. It means to lighten the ship. Most important things in our life seem to become unimportant when you come into the light and the truth of Jesus Christ. Just like the man that found the treasure in the field, everything else became literally unimportant. He was willing to sell out. Everything in our lives have to become unimportant. We have to be able to deal with it without delay. Amen. The demon of delay whispers, just a little bit longer. The demon of delay whispers, I'll do it tomorrow. The demon of delay says, I'll give my heart to the Lord next week. Amen. But Jesus is saying we need to do truth, to deal with it without delay, to lighten the ship. We've got a couple examples in the Word of God where Jonah was on the ship, right, and everything was the storm began to blow, and the men that were on the ship, you know, they said, what's going on? And they figured out it was because Jonah was running from God. But they didn't want to throw him overboard. Jonah suggested it, throw me overboard and everything will be all right. But what they did, they lightened the ship. They tried to get everything out. They were in the storm and they were trying to lighten everything out of the ship. Amen. But finally, they had to do what the man of God said, and that was to throw him overboard. And when they did, the sea became still. When we're trying to do things with all of our possessions and all of the mess and all the conflict and all the things that interrupt us, amen, it's hard for us to do truth. It has to be first. It has to be first in our life. The most important things have to become unimportant. There's nothing more important than your soul. There's nothing more important than your soul. This may be our last day here on earth. This may be our last hour. Where are you? Is it well with your soul? I want to ask you to buy the truth and sell it not. Amen. The story tells us about a rich young ruler, and he came to Jesus and he said, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "If that will be perfect or mature, go and sell that thou hast and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." Folks, we need treasure that's in heaven, not treasure on this earth. Amen. And once again, I'm not talking about it. Jesus talked a lot about money. As a matter of fact, he talked more about money than any other subject, because he says there's two gods. There's him and there's mammon, which is money. Amen. And so if it's got a hold of us, but the point is that we had to sell out everything that's keeping us back from buying this truth. Hallelujah. And when we do that, we'll have treasure in heaven. And the invitation is, come and follow me. Think about the invitation that Jesus was given to this man. But he went away sorrowfully because it says he had much goods. He wasn't able to make that transition to break away from this world, no matter what the world had to offer him, and to come and to follow Jesus. Amen. The disciples heard it, and they come to him, and they said, "You know, why did you say that?" You know, and Jesus said, "It is hard for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than it is for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." And the Bible says they were amazed, because in their time, the riches represented blessings from God. If somebody had a lot of wealth, they looked at them and said, "Well, he's blessed of God. He must be close to God." But Jesus was coming along and says, our possessions do not consist of the things that we own here on earth. Amen. Those are not the things. He said, "Beware of covetousness, for a man's life consists not of the abundance of things which he possesses." Amen. But he said to them, he said, "But with man things are impossible, but with God all things are possible." Jeremiah was sold out. He bought into God's word. He bought the field. He was bound in prison. As a matter of fact, it was a double prison, if you will. He was in the prison of Zedekiah, and they were surrounded by the Babylonians at that time. It was a lose-lose situation. But Jeremiah was going to buy the field. You may feel like you're trapped in prison. You may feel this morning like you just can't get loose from where you're at. You may feel like you're bound by the world or by an individual or by the things of this life. Amen. But I want you to know, hallelujah, that God can do all things. With God, all things are possible. When he was presented with the field, he says, "You have the right for redemption. I want you to know that you have a right to buy this truth." Hallelujah. Jesus Christ has already paid the price. You have a right. Society may have cast you out. Your family may have cast you out. But Jesus is saying, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Amen. You may feel like you're bound in prison, but God can do all things. Buy the truth. Hallelujah. Do it without delay. Lighten your ship. Amen. Nothing can keep you from the feet of Jesus except your own self. Nothing. I don't care what has you bound today. I don't care if you're a drug addict, alcoholic. I don't care what the situation is. I want you to know that nothing can keep you from the feet of Jesus. In Mark chapter 5, there's a story recorded about a man of the Gadarenes. And the Bible said he dwelt among the tombs, and no man could bind him. No, not with chains. Because he had often been bound with fetters and chains that had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and he worshiped without delay. Doeth truth. Amen. Worshipped him. Hallelujah. Up to 2,000 devils at least were in this man, because Jesus sent him into a field of swine that was approximately 2,000 pigs. And they all went into them and they all ran off the ledge violently. But Jesus delivered this man, and the whole city came out to see it. And they found the man clothed and in his right mind. Hallelujah. I want you to know that Jesus can give you the right thinking today. Jesus is able to deliver you. I said Jesus can deliver you. Jesus is able to make a way when there is no way. Hallelujah. Jesus can save you. Hallelujah. We just got to act upon it. We got to buy this truth and sell it not. Jeremiah bought the field, even though in the natural it just doesn't make sense. You may be here today and just thinking all the things that are going on around you, it just doesn't compute with me. I just can't believe it could be so true that Jesus would accept me. Amen. But I can remember as a 19-year-old alcoholic coming to the Pentecostal church for the first time. Hallelujah. The things didn't make sense to me. I didn't understand what was going on around me. Everybody was worshiping and praising God, and I was trying so desperately to strike up a conversation with somebody to get my mind off of what God was doing in that service that night, and that was speaking into my heart. Amen. And I came to the altar that night, and God filled me with the Holy Ghost, and I haven't had a drink of alcohol in 40-some years. My soul has been set free. Hallelujah. You don't know what true liberty is until you feel the power of the Holy Ghost in your life. The world thinks that they're living their own way, but the church is the one that has the freedom to live however we want to live. We just don't choose to go that way. That is the way of the world. We just don't choose alcohol. We just don't choose illicit sex. We don't choose the things that are causing the destruction of this world. Amen. But we have the power of the Holy Ghost. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Nothing can keep you from the feet of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah. My family got all concerned. Man, they went to their preacher at that time, different denominations, saying, we're worried about him. We think he's in a cult. And he told them, just don't worry about it. He's just on a spiritual high right now, and he'll come down after a little while. I'd just like to let you know that 40-some years later, I'm still on that spiritual high. And I'm not ever coming down. I'm going up to meet him, hallelujah, in that great apostolic meeting in the sky, because I'm going to buy the truth and sell it not, amen? Jeremiah put the contract, sealed it in an earthen vessel with witnesses all around. He took that contract and he sealed it. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, it says, in whom ye also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. It was an earthen vessel that he put this contract in, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in an earthen vessel. We are that earthen vessel today. We have the treasure of Christ. He said, I'm with you now, he told his disciples, but I'm going to be in you. Hallelujah. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for that? Amen. I brought a little earthen vessel. Take my water for me, please. I brought an earthen vessel, and I made a contract. You can't read it because it's in Hebrew. Amen. Let me do this real quick. Here's the seal. Here's the stuff that they bound it up with. And so the Bible said that they had one that was sealed, a contract that was sealed. And I got to put this down. I'm going to seal this contract. And the seal they put on there, it was sealed until the purchased property was redeemed. Took his signature, if you will, and he smashed that seal onto that document, and he sealed it, and he put it in the earthen vessel. But not only that, but the Bible says there was an open copy also that was put in there. I won't tie it up. But this was the way that they used to keep manuscripts. They would keep in earthen vessels in the earth and within caves. And the ancient Jewish custom was called Geniza, which simply means to hide or to put away. It's derived from the word ganza, which means depository or treasure. A treasure, hallelujah, in an earthen vessel. This earthen vessel, folks, represents us. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. This sealed sign represents the Holy Spirit that God wants to give to you, that God wants to keep you by his Spirit. It's there. It's put away. It's held up until Jesus comes to redeem his purchased possession. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. It ought to make somebody shout to realize that Christ is in us. We are sealed by the power of his presence until his coming for the purchased possession. He died for you. He's not going to leave you now. He's not going to let you down. Hitoromasata. Woo! The question is, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Amen. It's kept until the coming of Jesus Christ. And so I was praying and I said, Lord, you know, there's an open manuscript in there. And I don't know, I just made this up on my own. I don't know if it's real, but this is what I felt the Lord telling me. He said that's because they could get it out. And they could read and they would know what was in this sealed possession right here. They would know what was in there. They could read it. And I just thought, you know, that's how God works with us. Sometimes we need to reach deep into our lives and to pull out what we realize that God is in our lives. Amen. There's an interesting portion of scripture here in Jeremiah where it seemed that Jeremiah seemed a little nervous. And Jeremiah said, "Oh Lord, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee." You know, he said, I bought the field, verse 25, and says, "Yeah, the old sovereign God, you have told me to buy the field, paying good money," in one translation said, "for it before thee in the witnesses, even though the city will soon be handed over to the Babylonians." You know, he's praying here, but I was detecting. He was like reminding God, you know, you are great and you did all these great things and I purchased it just like you said, but you know, that's going to be handed over to the Babylonians. In verse 27, God answered him, said, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh, the God of all earthen vessels." He's the God of you. He's the God of me. Whether we relinquish our lives to him or not, we're still his. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He created us. Amen. He said, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh, and there is nothing. Is there anything too hard for me?" Is there anything too hard for me? Isaiah reminded him in verse 17, "And there is nothing too hard for thee." And God responded back to him, "Is there anything too hard for me?" The answer is, there is nothing too hard for our God. Amen. So we pull out our manuscript and we find, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me?" And we come and we say, "Well, we need deliverance in our life. Is there anything too hard for our God? I need a healed relationship this morning. Is there anything to..." Let God remind you, reach down deep within the vessel. And let God remind you today that there is nothing that our God can do. Hallelujah. I need direction in my life. I need a healing emotionally. I need a healing financially. Hallelujah. I need a healing in my body. God is our healer. God is our way maker. God is our Savior. And to know the love of Christ with pathless knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundant above all that we are able to ask or think, according to the power. Woo! I said, according to the power that worketh in us. Let me tell the church, there is nothing that you cannot do when you do it in the name of Jesus Christ. You've got God in you. Hallelujah. We have the power of a God that can do all things. I'm getting ready to close, so if you all want to stand. The Bible tells about the story of a man brought his possessed child to Jesus. "Can you help me?" And Jesus' response to him is, "If thou canst believe." Look at your neighbor and say, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And the straightway the father of the child cried out and said, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. I believe, Lord, but help my unbelief, Jesus." And I would like to suggest to you today that you don't need much strength. You don't need much belief. You don't need much understanding. You don't need to have all your ducks in a row, as they say. You don't need much faith, just a little bit of faith. Just a little bit, and say, yeah, I believe, Lord. Hallelujah. He bought the land in Anathoth. Anathoth was only a few miles away. It was only a few miles away from Jerusalem. And I want you to know that the kingdom of God is nigh unto us. It just simply means, by definition, to heed. Anathoth means to heed, to pay attention, and by implication, to respond. To respond to God. Amen. I don't know where you're at in your walk with the Lord, but it's time to respond. To buy this truth. Embrace it. Sell it not. Amen. I want to invite you this morning, if that's your desire for more of God, if you've never received the Holy Spirit in your life with the evidence of speaking of tongues, today's your day. All you have to do is respond. Amen. Come up to this altar this morning. There'll be people to help you, hallelujah, to pray with you, to give you direction, amen. If you're going through something in your life, I want you to understand, hallelujah, there's nothing too hard for our God. He's not up there with a baseball bat ready to club you over the head, but he's got arms of love. And like I said at the beginning, true love wouldn't be love if we didn't respond to God. Amen. Would you get out from where you are, come up to this altar, and respond to the presence of God? Amen. Praise you, Jesus. God, we love you.